Hi, I'm Stephen John Drew from Better Podcasting, a proud member of the Gunna Geek Network, just like the show you're listening to now. The opinions expressed are those of the individual hosts. Check out all the other geeky podcasts at GunnaGeekNetwork.com and get ready because geekiness begins in 3, 2, 1.
You have been granted clearance by Director Jeffrey Mace. Stand by for S.H.I.E.L.D. debriefing. All information to be discussed here is classified and may only be discussed among agents granted clearance by the S.H.I.E.L.D. director.
Now it's time for your scheduled debriefing. I'm Director Stargate Pioneer.
I'm Agent Haley.
And I'm Agent Lauren.
Welcome to Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., a Marvel Comic Universe fan show. This is show number 159, discussing the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Season 4, Episode 11, Wake Up! This show is recorded on Wednesday, January 25th, 2017. Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. is a fan-based podcast on the ABC television show Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Marvel's Daredevil Jessica Jones, and Luke Cage on Netflix, the Marvel Cinematic Universe, and the Marvel Comic Universe in general.
Because of Turtle Man.
If you'd like to talk to us about Turtle Man and his Turtle Man, you can find us at our website, legendsofshield.com.
You can leave us a voicemail on what to name Turtle Man at 844-THE-BUS-1 or 844-843-2871.
You can check out our Facebook page, Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. Podcast.
You can find us on Twitter at Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D.
If you're listening to the audio version, you can check out our video version of the podcast at youtube.com/GunnaGeek.
Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. is a proud member of the GunnaGeek.com network.
This time on episode 159 of Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., we're going to be giving away a Phil Coulson fan art made by Jaime Faye and donated by Black Adam. We're going to be talking about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. episode Wake Up. We're going to be talking about the weekly Marvel news, your feedback, and highlights from the live chat room, which you can find at www.geeks.live. Ladies, we've been really excited about this for like half a year. Can you believe it's been like 7 months since Black Adam gave us this wonderful fan art of director Agent Coulson from MegaCon? Can you believe it's been that long?
I certainly can't, because I can't keep track of time at all.
I can, because I lived in another state when we got that.
That's right. So what it is, it's an 11 by 17 art on the, what do you call it, landscape? It's not portrait. It is portrait.
It's portrait.
Just wonderful fan art of Director Coulson.
Hot dog, not hamburger.
That's right. And
you'll never heard that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, that's right. So we finally are giving this away this week. And we've had some wonderful entries. We actually got a new entry this week as well, didn't we, Haley?
Yes, we did. We got an email and somebody followed instructions and bribed us like they were supposed to.
So it was Calvin Propovich, and his best Coulson moment was, I would have to say that it was when he sacrificed himself in the first Avengers film. It made the stakes real for the rest of the team. I mean, when a human with no special powers other than his wit is willing to pay the price, what does it say about the demigods and literal gods he shares the company of?
And then came the bribery.
Yeah.
He said, as a follow-up, if my case is not good enough on its own merits, I have attached a picture of my puppy as a bribe.
And it is a very cute puppy. Like, really cute.
I mean, for further future reference, we prefer cash bribes, but we will take cute animal pictures.
Yeah, I am all for cute animal pictures because we are in dark days these days, and cute animal pictures are really like all that keeps me going about 50 to 60% of the time.
Yep, I two or three times today watched the video of a dog bringing her new puppies to her owner and piling them on top of her.
Oh my God, I've seen that one. It's so amazing.
Yep.
So, with all the great entries we've had into the contest, ladies, because we know I don't get to choose the winner. You choose right. the winner. Who's going to win this wonderful fan art?
The puppy.
Yeah, I would kind of have to agree, not only because of the puppy, but because when Coulson sacrificed himself and kind of gave everyone stakes, it was sort of the moment that propelled Coulson from that guy in the background to kind of the fandom rallying point. Y'all remember the big Coulson lived things after that?
Yes. Yeah.
So I think that is kind of the perfect moment. Plus, that puppy is so cute.
Well, congratulations, Calvin. I can't override the ladies here. You have won with your last minute entry into the contest. And we really appreciate everybody that entered into the contest. We were reliving a lot of great Coulson moments. So thank you very much, Calvin. Send me your address on email, StargatePioneer@GunnaGeek.com. And I will get this out to you, hopefully this Saturday or the following Saturday, depending on when you hear this. So congratulations, Calvin, and thank you for everybody for participating. And if you didn't win and you're like, oh man, I need a chance to win something else, well, guess what? We next week will be starting our giveaway for the X-Men Collector Core Crate.
Yay!
So we'll announce what we need for that next week and probably do the unboxing the week after that. And we'll roll out with a great giveaway there. So thank you very much, everybody, for joining in on the fun, because we like the fun. Ladies?
We do.
Yeah.
And from the last giveaway, friend of the show, at Born to Eat Bacon, was generous enough to donate the Doctor Strange mug to me. So thank you very much. I am currently drinking white chocolate peppermint tea out of it, and it is wonderful.
Mm.
Sounds really good.
Yes, drinking tea out of Benedict Cumberbatch's head.
Not his skull, his head. Completely different.
This isn't like the monkeys in Indiana Jones 2, is it?
No. Tea is not brains. I mean, I guess I'm trying to think, could you actually make tea from brains? And the thing is, brains is mostly fat. So if you were to I guess you could dry it down, but it is mostly just fat and water. And since tea is dried, usually plant matters steeped in stuff, well, it would be really gross tea. I wouldn't recommend it.
And on that note, ladies, are you ready to talk some exciting Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.?
Yes.
Yes.
Here we go. Ladies, we had a great episode, and the creative team is no stranger to Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. here. And I know, Lauren, you want to talk about the director because you've talked about him before.
Yes, the director is Jesse Bochco, son of Stephen Bochco, who you might know from every law show from the 80s. And he has directed 7 episodes of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., including 4,722 Hours, Watch Dogs, Love in the Time of Hydra, Girl in the Flower Dress. He's also done 6 episodes of Dallas, the reboot, not the original. 2 episodes of Commander-in-Chief, 10 episodes of NYPD Blue.
2 episodes of Prison Break. So, yeah, he's got a lot of cred behind him. So thank you very much. And by the way, he is the son of famed director and producer Stephen Bochco. Right?
Yep.
Back me up here. Okay, good.
Yeah, that is what I said.
Yep.
Haley, we've got a great writer for this episode, too, don't we?
Right. Drew Z. Greenberg has 12 writing credits since 2001. He did an episode of Firefly, 3 episodes of Smallville, a couple episodes of The OC, a couple of Dexter, 19 episodes of Star Wars The Clone Wars, episode of Caprica, bunch of episodes of Warehouse 13 and Arrow, and 8 episodes so far of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., including Wake Up, Meet the New Boss, Absolution, Watch Dogs, Among Us, Hide, The Dirty Half Dozen, Who You Really Are, and Face My Enemy.
So also now 22 episodes of Buffy.
Ooh.
Yes.
He wrote 22 episodes of Buffy?
Well, he was story editor for 22 and wrote 6.
Okay. So two of the creative team have done 7 and 8 episodes already of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And they're not throwaway episodes. They're all good episodes, the 15 that we listed off. So guess what? We got a great episode from them as well. As we start our discussion on the episode every week, Wake Up, we're going to talk about the meaning of the title, which in this case is layered upon layered upon layered upon layered. Right, Lauren?
Yeah. So the first thing I thought of when I heard it was some creepypasta, of all things. Creepypasta, for those who don't know, is kind of short little weird stories originating from the internet. And this particular one is called Wake Up, and it's particularly relevant to tonight's episode with May. I'll read it because, again, it's short, it's quick, good creepypasta is. It has been reported that some victims of torture during the act would retreat into a fantasy world from which they could not wake up. In this catatonic state, the victim lived in a world just like their normal one, except they weren't being tortured. The only way that they realized they needed to wake up was a note they found in their fantasy world. It would tell them about their condition and tell them to wake up. Even then, it would often take months until they were ready to discard their fantasy world and please wake up.
I feel, Haley, I feel like I might actually be in a fantasy world doing this podcast right now after that, don't you?
Well, that's the point, is we found the note telling us to wake up.
We did.
Thank you, internet. I didn't want to sleep.
I love creepypasta.
So you had May trying to wake up. You had LMD May basically waking up. You had Batty, Dr. Batty, who, by the way, if you haven't listened to Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. before, we have renamed Dr. Radcliffe Dr. Batty because of his time in Spartacus. And
as Battyatus. So it, just Batty is fun to say and sounds a little bit like Batty, B-A-D-D-I-E, which he sort of is.
Yep. Oh,
definitely is. And then you had Coulson waking up to the fact that there's a mole among them. This is just tons of waking up. So I'm glad this was an appropriately titled episode and layered into the title. Now, S.H.I.E.L.D., we sometimes talk about the status of S.H.I.E.L.D. that's going on, and it's kind of in a turbulent state right now. I mean, you got Coulson, who's supposed to be running the operations of it, but you still have Mason being the head of S.H.I.E.L.D., and then you got Talbot being the government's director oversight. I'm not quite sure what the whole thing is, but apparently S.H.I.E.L.D. reports to Talbot now. And I kind of forgot how that whole thing went. So you've got all that going on, and you have an agent that has not signed the Sokovia Accords. So there's some explaining to do.
Are you talking about Daisy or are you talking about Yo-Yo?
I'm talking about Daisy. We saw Yo-Yo sign it.
Yeah,
that was a question I had. Did Daisy actually sign the Accords? I didn't see her. I don't think she has.
Those hearings were about her signing the Accords.
Wouldn't you just want her to sign the accord?
But because she did all this other stuff, having not signed the accords, they're trying to, I guess, figure out if she could be prosecuted for that or if she would fall under S.H.I.E.L.D.'s jurisdiction and be like, oh, she was doing all this undercover.
Well, and I'm gonna have to think through the timeline. She left S.H.I.E.L.D. before. Did she leave S.H.I.E.L.D. before Captain America Civil War came out?
No, it was after. It was the last episode, right?
I think so. Okay, because I was going to wonder if they could make the argument she was undercover when the Sokovia Accords became a thing and we couldn't pull her out to fill out paperwork.
Oh, no, that wasn't it at all. She never had the opportunity to, and then she left. So coming back into S.H.I.E.L.D., she would have to. Yeah.
I know, but I was wondering if, you know, they're a clandestine organization, they could just fudge the paperwork and make that argument like, hey, listen, she's been undercover. We haven't had an opportunity to bring her in to sign the accords.
But then you wouldn't have had the great opportunity for Coulson and Yo-Yo to go into Senator Nadir's office and get caught.
Right, but they were going to do the hearings anyway, is what I'm saying. So during the hearings, you say that. Like, you have your story prepared.
There's going to even be more hearings now,
apparently. Well, yeah, now. Because, well, I mean, yeah. if we're already in the position where we're going to lie to the Senate and say she was undercover.
Just lie big.
Yeah, come up with a solid lie.
Well, Fitz does great work, so he could have done it.
And it's like, she stole this money. Yeah, it was to maintain her cover.
But that money wasn't recovered by the United States government. It was
Right, it was distributed in a way to maintain her cover.
I'm really curious now. Okay, so I've never been exactly positive. Okay, you know how they say that most of, like, there's like a good percentage of people undercover in like white nationalist groups and stuff like that who are actually government informants and things like that. What do they do with, say, like the profits that they get from like drug stuff and weapon stuff? Like,
that was the whole thing under the Fast and the Furious. Well, it was part of it anyway. Under Fast and Furious.
It was part of it, yeah, but
so it's supposed to go back into a fund for, in this case, the ATF, but it's supposed to go back into a fund that is either given back to the government as a recoup, or it is in the operational budget. Take, for example, seized automobiles and boats and planes and helicopters, whatever, that are involved in the drug stuff for legal action. It's actually seized. It's not, you know, transactions for undercover work. That is all sold at auction, and all that money goes back to offset the costs of these operations for those, you know, DEA, FBI sort of operations that occur. So that's what's supposed to happen. I suspect in reality.
Yeah. In reality, I mean, you have that whole thing that it was in the news a lot last year about police officers in certain counties and things like that searching cars. And if you have cash or stuff like that, they'll take it and be like, oh, how do I know you're not going to use this to buy drugs? So they'll just take it. And one of the sheriff's offices actually near me was under scrutiny because they bought like a margarita machine with it.
Some of this stems from the law of the sea, the international law of the sea, because if you seize some pirate activity as it's taking place or after it's taking place or whatever, the ship gets a bounty of that. That's the way the United States Navy works. That's the way the Great Britain Navy works as well. They get basically a finder's fee. Now, whatever that is, nominally, I've heard it's somewhere around 10 to 30%. That's a lot of money, but it's distributed amongst the entire crew of the vessel. So if you're talking...
So nobody can write Daisy a letter of marque?
I don't know what they can or cannot do. This is going to be exciting to see how it goes from here until May, because... And not Agent May. Like May, May 2017. Because there's so much in play right now, and we've never met the superior yet.
Yeah, I don't know if I completely missed that or if that was a new development tonight, but the whole thing about whoever Nadir is answering to,
that came
through me for a loop.
That came about last week. The superior came about last week.
The watchdogs brought it up.
Oh yeah. Okay.
So this was only the second time that the superior has even been mentioned, and that the fact that Nadir is working for somebody even above her, and the question is who is that? And don't forget, the watchdogs have that great character as well that was in the last ship. And then just about every other character, actor that you've seen over the last 20 or 30 years. All right. I know you ladies want to talk about May, so let's get to the flashbacks. Let's start 5 days ago.
Remember when Morpheus was talking to Agent Smith in The Matrix? And he was bringing up, like, our first Matrix was designed to be a paradise, and you rejected it. That's what's happening.
Exactly. I think we discussed that last week, too.
I wasn't here, so I don't know that. But
Then, actually, my husband happened to walk in at about that time, and he looked up and he goes, oh, look, it's the Matrix.
True. That's exactly what I thought as well. But 5 days ago was actually the capture of May, how they went about it. Mm-hmm. So you actually get to see where May left the base for the last time and where
it's what we thought it was, which was before the big mission with Ghost Rider and all that stuff.
Right, because we had questions about the timeline there, so that was solved there. And then also we found out what was it called, a brain gauge or something like that.
It was like a neural something.
Neural assessment gauge, that's right. So
that's it.
We find out how her consciousness, her essence, her being was transferred from her brain into the LMD, thus leading Ada to say, we don't need May anymore.
And then being practical,
Dr. Vatti is like, proving what I said, right, that they're doing the whole neural scanning thing and making basically a copy of her brain. They need to keep her around basically as a backup.
Yep. Got to back that copy up. Of course, at the end, I'm going to skip ahead a little bit here. At the end, we find Batty has made an LMD of himself. And I'm wondering, is the Batty that meets with Senator Nandir at the end, is that an LMD? Because the next time we actually see Batty with Ada and May, it's in a totally different environment. So there actually might have been a couple, at least, LMDs of Batty running around.
Dr. Batty's the new Koenig.
Could be. We're going to find out next week what exactly the Koenigs are going to be.
I'm so excited.
Is it next week? Yeah, it's next week. It's going to be fun.
See, I feel like at this point, they can't be LMDs, though, because they made a big deal about, you know, Batty being the one to invent them. And that just started this year, which is disappointing.
What else could it be?
We'll see. I mean, maybe it's a rival technology.
Or maybe it's like a prototype technology, like he built it working for somebody else before.
Could be, and he just wanted it again, and he didn't have access to the Koenigs anymore?
This is like Mark II. This is...
Maybe they're aliens.
Maybe they're Skrulls.
But, yeah, so when Fitz came in to confront Dr. Radcliffe, were you expecting that at all?
He just walked up to the guard. Here, I need that. And the guard just gives him his gun, right?
Yeah, like...
Yeah.
Was it an icer, though? I think it was an icer. So it's not supposed to be lethal, but you're not supposed to shoot an icer to the head, are you?
I wouldn't think so, because the skin on your head is very thin.
Yes.
Yeah.
Haley's like, I don't care where you shoot it. Headshot is where you're supposed to.
I'm just... Speaking from personal experience, a small blow to the head can result in a lot of bleeding.
Yes, because all of your blood vessels are just right here. And, you know, when you shoot a tranquilizer at, you know, a person or an animal or whatever, the idea is to shoot it into muscle mass because that's how it gets into the bloodstream. It gets absorbed by... And if you shoot it into the head, it's just going to smack into bone. And there's no chance for it. Like, the needle's going to break, and it's going to be gross, and it's not fun.
Either way, I did not expect Fitz to shoot Batty in the head. Did not at all. I didn't realize what was going on until he was actually pointing the gun at him, and then I thought, oh, this could be an LMD. And, of course, it was.
Yeah, that was when I was like, oh, no, and then
He had a line. I don't remember what it's something like. I just want to protect people or something like that.
Priority. And no, my number
just
one priority.
I wanted to protect you, Leo.
I think it was that's my priority saying. Is to protect people. I think that's what it was.
Yeah, it was that was Ada's programming, and that's.
Yep. But like when there was a split second when he was pointing the gun at him, I was like, he's not an LMD, and this is going to get real messy. But no, he was a robot.
So,
and I was kind of relieved.
Now you have no idea who else is a robot, because we know at least one other LMD is walking around S.H.I.E.L.D.
We know at least one mole is. We don't know they're an LMD.
No, we know. No, he said there's a second.
The other one.
No, he said there was another one, but I mean, could that have been referring to his LMD?
That's what I was thinking. That's what I'm thinking now.
Yeah.
Because they kind of, you know, they red herring you into thinking maybe it's Mac. For a while there, I was thinking maybe it's Talbot. But yeah, Mac's whole suspicious behavior, leaving and everything. And it turns out it has nothing, as far as we know, to do with him being an LMD at all.
Totally got to talk about Mac. We got to talk about Mac. Oh my God. We got to talk about Yo-Yo. We got to talk about Hope and Nicole. Oh my gosh, Mac's past coming up out of nowhere. I mean, we got that little tidbit with his brother, right?
The saddest backstory.
I know. Mm-hmm. This whole family life is just totally ruined. And then his SHIELD life has been totally ruined. He's got a good, legitimate reason for being the way he is.
Yeah, like, we had a little hint of it with his brother, and then we find out, oh, his daughter was, like, 4 days old when she died, and he and his wife just, like, never really got over it, and she doesn't handle it well on the anniversary, which, I mean, you'd understand.
He never said she was his wife. He said she was his ex.
His ex. Yeah.
So I don't know if they were married or not, but you could take it either. It doesn't matter. They were having a child together. So
yeah.
Woo. And so Yo-Yo's like, I'm out of here. And Mac finally, Yo-Yo's talking, right? She's like, no, I can't believe you lied to me. You're with other women. You're not telling me, whatever. And she's trying to go to leave. And then he finally is like, wait a minute. This is what it was. And then she's like, oh my. And I don't think she really felt bad about saying what she did because he didn't tell her first. But I think it's like Oliver Queen over on Arrow with the whole son thing. Oliver should have told Felicity. In this case, Mac probably should have told her. But at what point do you do that in the relationship?
Communication, people. I keep saying this over and over again. Communication is a good thing. Use your words.
It makes for bad storytelling.
But it makes for good relationships.
So Stephen J, generic name in the chat, actually has a point here. He says, can we just talk about the fact that he literally got up and left. I feel like there was at least time to get her a coffee or something.
Yeah, like, it's as far as we know, their first night together. And that was so cute, by the way. I was so happy for them. And then everything went wrong. And then he's just like, oh, he gets a text and he's like, gotta go, just leaves. And it's like, is not how I pictured this going.
Yeah, there's been a change of plans, which I actually thought that he was doing something else for the operation because you know how Fury and Coulson do that layer and layer upon layer sort of operational mode. So that's what I kind of figured it was. I had no idea it was really personal. And Mac never takes personal days. So this is like, big thing.
You know, it's a TV show. Showing somebody taking a personal day to go to the dentist does not make for a good TV show.
Well, it could if you do it right.
I think Mac would have blown off a text from his dentist. That's just not going to happen.
No, he's like, oh no, I forgot my appointment. There's going to be that cancellation fee. Oh no.
Then they have to run a SHIELD op to get him in there to avoid the cancellation fee.
I'm sure Fitz and Simmons could figure something out there. I mean, isn't SHIELD Medical all taking place right there?
You'd think so. But then again, SHIELD does like weird stuff, like bring people back to life. So
yeah, but if you go to the SHIELD dentist, they give you fillings with a SHIELD logo on them. And it's just, it's not what you want.
I want that though.
So oddly enough, in the Mockingbird comic that was out last year, the first, I don't know, five episodes or so.
The first five or so issues.
She had to keep going back to get her checkups from the SHIELD medical facility. And then all of a sudden the SHIELD medical facility, actually, I won't spoil anything, but there's something that happened there. There was actually a big detailed diagram of the entire medical facility underground somewhere. And it was really cool. If you haven't read that already, which you should have, if you're listening to this podcast, you should go get that
you totally
run.
Should. There's some fantastic sight gags in there, like the superheroes that are in the waiting room and what they're there for. It's great. You see, like Tony Stark looking through STD pamphlets.
Of course he is.
Oh, I forgot about all that. That's great. Apparently Yo-Yo is okay about Felinda.
Oh yeah, Yo-Yo ships Felinda, like, just like we all do. She's just like, come on, stop being so slow and get together. I don't have all day.
Do you think she would still encourage him knowing that May is an LMD?
Maybe.
I don't know. It's sort of that question, if somebody has all the functional memories of that person, can they really be considered? Well, no, they are no longer that person because their memories have diverged, but...
They are, and the programming is taking over. Like, there's actual programming that's preventing her from telling him that she is an LMD.
Which is, like, horrible. Because how awful would that be to know and be aware of all the stuff and want to tell somebody, look, this horrible thing is happening to me, and I need to tell you, and you are physically unable to. It's like a nightmare.
I'm not sure. Although, if Yo-Yo knew that May was an LMD, she would know that the real May would be out there and wanting to rescue that real May. So, kind of a moot point there, but... All right, so back on the shipping level here, shipping theme, we've got Mac and Yo-Yo, and they're officially a thing now. What is their ship?
I still say Yo-Yo Mac.
All right.
That's fine.
So we'll call it Yo-Yo Mac unless something else picks up on the interwebs. All right. What did you think about the Bahrain at the end?
Oh, that was horrible.
So for everybody's edification, in case you don't remember, way back when we got the background of why May is called the Cavalry, and it's because she went into a building and basically took care of everything in the building, including, unfortunately, a little girl who she wanted to save. And just,
yeah, but the little girl was the inhuman who was killing everyone.
Mm-hmm.
So Batty took a simulation for her to make her happy to say that May was able to save the girl. And she even invoked Andrew. So she is back in that time in her mind. She is not trying to get out. This is something she's content with. And I'm not sure if she's going to start to see the bounds of the simulation or not, because she could be totally focused on just the fact that the girl was actually saved and she's wanted this since it happened. So, and the Cavalry incident happened before Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. started. So you're talking, what, 6-7 years ago at this point?
Something like.
Yeah, so this has been stewing with her for a long time. So, I don't know. It's going to be interesting how they write May around that. Like, is it going to, you know, we always think it's going to be longer than it really is. So, is it going to be until the end of the season, or is it just going to be an episode or two?
I think what's probably going to happen is we're going to see a little bit of, you know, May in her dream world, like after that, and like living her happiest life there. And then, you know, maybe for an episode or so, and then we're going to see her waking up from that and having to deal with actual reality where she didn't save the girl and all this other stuff happens. And plus she's been replaced by a robot. And everything will be horrible. But then maybe she and Coulson will get together.
Or they could do something like they did with Simmons after they sent her to that other planet, where she comes back and we see her reacting to everything, and then later we see what her experience was.
And they did that same thing, that flashback with May of how she got captured. So could be. So, Lauren, your science babies are fighting.
Yes, I am unhappy. Like, this whole episode just made me very unhappy.
So, question for you. So, he's in bed and he is going through the research that he's doing. Is this their little cave, their quarters inside the headquarters, or is this their apartment with the breakfast nook?
I think it's their place inside their headquarters. I don't think it's their apartment.
Okay.
Because he seems kind of very focused on this project, which doesn't lead me to believe that he's going home.
Yeah, just like Senator Nadir's brother didn't go home. He's at the bottom of the ocean.
Oh,
too soon.
Daisy brought him up.
Yeah, that was, I'm like, on the one hand, like ice burn, and then on the other, knowing what we know happened to him, maybe antagonizing her while in the middle of this Senate hearing might not be such a good idea.
Right, but she doesn't know what happened to him.
No, she doesn't.
Yeah, she doesn't know if he's dead, right? Yeah. As far as she knows, he's alive.
Yeah, she just knows that Nadir took him.
Because you tend to assume that people aren't going to kill their siblings. I mean, just normal people tend to assume that.
Haley, have you ever wanted to kill your brother?
Probably, but I didn't do it.
Exactly. Much of, you know, you say, I'm going to kill him, and then you don't follow through on it because you are a normal person.
Well, I don't know. You could have killed him and made your own LMD of your brother. I have no idea what your capabilities really are.
It sounds like a lot of work.
All right. Well,
I think you do know that I'm fairly lazy. You should know that by now.
Yeah, but you wanted to rule the entire world, or at least a portion of it. So
yeah, but I don't, because I'm kind of lazy.
Okay.
It's like one of those nice fantasy you wouldn't want to actually do it things.
All right. So
the world is a mess and I just need to rule it.
So talking about the world is a mess and somebody needing to rule it, we didn't get any watchdogs unless you want to consider the security team for Senator Nadir being watchdogs, which might have been, I don't know. But so we didn't really get any watchdogs. We didn't get Lola. We didn't get the Superior other than a mention. We didn't get the Darkhold book other than a mention. And we did not get the Zephyr 1, but we did. And I just have to bring this up again. We got Mr. Talbot and his mustache. So both were present in this episode.
And basically every line he kept saying is gold.
I wonder if the other actors on set are like trying to blow the mustache off their own face, just looking at his.
Could be, but he was, what was he talking about? Little fart bubbles and
something like that. Yeah. I just remember the word fart and I just started laughing.
It's, you know, it seemed like it was ADR'd because I think he said something else when they were filming and then they did a hard, if you watch the scene, and being a producer of audio and video, I'm actually paying attention to this now. So what happened is there was a hard cut and then Talbot's inflection changed just a little bit. So it wasn't like a smack dab on ADR, and then he said that line about the fart bubbles or whatever, and then they pan back to him and you're like, oh, they ADR'd that in. So I think he said a naughty word in there or something that was supposed to be like a naughty word, and they exchanged that in.
Or else maybe just like whatever line they had just didn't work then.
Yeah, it could be.
So yeah, I know they do that sometimes.
All right, ladies, this is the point where I turn it over to you for what you liked about the episode or any last thoughts. So Haley, I'm going to go to you first. What do you got?
I was a little upset that they brought in a whole team of S.H.I.E.L.D. agents at the end to Batty's place and they didn't search that apartment. It's like, oh, we got them. Let's all go now.
Yeah.
Like,
that
come on, guys.
Just go to the back
room.
That was
not good decision making.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, this guy makes murderous robots for fun. Maybe check that place out.
He's got to be storing them somewhere. Find out where they are. Yeah, because there's no assembly line anywhere, right? I watched Ex Machina last Saturday night. There was an assembly
line. I haven't seen that one. I have it, and I still haven't watched it.
The ending was a little bit depressing for me, but the actual story was okay and thought-provoking.
Like, I'm like totally into stories about, as we have established, what makes somebody a person.
I won't spoil it at all other than to say there was an assembly line and there was several different versions of the robots around the place. So,
also, dancing Oscar Isaac. Huh?
So is that it, Haley?
Yeah, aside from quotes.
Yep. So Lauren, over to you.
Yes. I really liked all the stuff with Robo-May, unsurprisingly, given what I've just said. I feel very, very bad for her.
She's trying to do the best she can. And she's got mixed thoughts in her. And it's just, it's painful to watch. It's like, she knows she's good at heart, but she's programmed to do bad things. And isn't there a part of her programming which hasn't been activated so that he can get the Darkhold book? He mentioned that in this episode, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if it was in this episode, but yeah.
No, I think he mentioned it straight to her.
I think he did. Yeah. And yeah, it's just, it's so depressing to think about, but it's intriguing too. Like, what would you do in that situation?
I don't know. It wouldn't be me. It would be my LMD me.
No, but you wake up.
No, I mean, right now you are an LMD. What if you were to find out that you are an LMD?
Yeah, like everything, you realize, oh, these memories that I've always thought are mine are someone else's.
I'd be a like, beach bum somewhere because I know I'd be, you know, I'd put $10 in the bank and get it a million years from now and be rich. Go screw off, you know, for years and years and years. I wouldn't go into work. Are you kidding?
Okay, but I mean, you might still need food or something because obviously she's eating. If she wasn't eating at all, that would be suspicious.
Yeah, you have to like keep the organic parts going.
You guys are no fun.
Yeah, didn't you see Terminator Genesis? The Terminators age.
I didn't see Terminator
Genesis. No, I did not see
it. It is a perfectly adequate movie.
I kind of stopped after Salvation.
It's better than Salvation.
All right, I'll put it on the list. I mean, I just got around to Ex Machina. I mean, give me a break. I got Sully on the tab for this weekend. I haven't seen that one yet. Okay. Unless if I go see the NASA movie.
Go see the NASA movie.
I'll try.
Quite good. It's so good.
All right, Haley, I think we're at quotes. Go.
Okay. There are a festering cesspool of toxic waste fires.
That's great. Especially what's going on in politics. We're not going to discuss politics on this podcast, but that was an awesome statement at this point in time.
Yes.
I'm happy Turtle Man came out to play this morning.
Are we not doing phrasing anymore?
I was playing that and I did a double take. I was like, what did she just say? And I backed it up and they got out of it. But oh my gosh, that is right on the line. That is the line.
Please, I don't need to read a file on you two to know. Nobody likes a smartass. That hasn't been my experience.
That's true, because everybody involved in this sort of thing, it's sarcastic smartass, it's Tony Stark, it's what, that's the difference between Marvel and DC, because Marvel has a bunch of smartasses in it.
Yep. And everyone smiles. It's weird, isn't it?
Right.
Talbot's always pissed.
Yeah.
They did bring up the sun, though, again. I mean, he brought it up, but it's like, you did this and you did that. They kidnapped my son. Come on, dude.
Yeah, I mean, I you got to give him that.
Yep, that's it.
All right. Great episode. I liked it. I mean, you ladies liked the episode, right?
I did.
Yep.
Next week, I love the title, by the way. I didn't believe it, and I went back to look again. I was like, this is not this. Hot potato soup.
Okay, so is Koenig the hot potato?
I don't know, but if he's soup, then this, if he's the hot potato and he's soup, then we got bigger problems going around. Did you see the promo for next week?
Yes.
Yeah, judging by the promo, it's something to do with the Darkhold book and Koenig's hiding it and not knowing which one has it or who did what with it or anything. So that's probably with the hot potato, but soup, I'm not sure about that. If the Darkhold book ends up like soup, we do have big problems. All right. Well, that's it for the episode. We're going to get in to some news. Wow. We have several interesting stories this week. It wasn't a blockbuster news week, but we did have some important announcements that came out. First of all, we have some movie news dealing with the Black Panther.
Yes, the first set photos have been released on the Best of Marvel Twitter account. They've put four pictures.
Yeah, it was like three or four pictures.
Yeah, they have like Chadwick Boseman and Danny Guerra, Lupita Nyong'o and Martin Freeman all just chilling. And I'm very excited about this movie.
A lot of people are. It's pretty cool. And yes. there's another movie that a lot of people are excited about. Matter of fact, I think the people that are most excited about this movie right now are the people that rent out the Star trailers.
Yeah, so it seems. The Russo brothers on Monday, January 23rd, took a picture, put it on Facebook, and shared this image of, which we will be linking, of
a never-ending line of trailers.
Never-ending row of trailers, and said that it's their first day of filming.
Yep. And then you scroll down a little farther, and you find out that many of the actors don't have scripts yet.
Yep.
Well, you know, Marvel snipers and y'all, you got to keep it all in the family as much as you can.
Yep. So, like, they were saying Jeremy Renner and Elizabeth Olsen don't have their scripts yet. And then Dave Bautista replied to this on Twitter saying, well, that makes three of us, and I start filming tomorrow.
Oh, no.
Hashtag Marvel Shroud of Secrecy.
They're just going to do what they do on, like, Mexican telenovelas where they just have, like, an earpiece and somebody saying their lines in their ears.
Have to produce the lines right there and there in true S.H.I.E.L.D. fashion.
Yep. Yeah. Where's the Patrick Stewart acting gif?
Would the Sorkin School of Acting or Production or whatever that, or the writer school, would maybe they need to send the writers to that. Maybe they're behind schedule. I don't know. Let's see. Well, this was unexpected, this next news story, because I thought we kind of had a full slate of superhero shows on TV. I mean, we got the Powerless show coming out on next week on February 2nd and stuff like that. Well, guess what? We get to add one more to the mix.
Yep. This one I thought had been shelved. I think we talked about it like, what, maybe a year ago. Matt Nix had been kicking around an idea for like a family and their kids, or one of their kids or both of their kids, develop mutant powers. So they go on the run, and it got shelved when they announced Legion, and then they were going to do Hellfire Club, and they shelved that. Well, Matt Nix's show is back, and Bryan Singer has signed on to direct the pilot.
That was the big news, that Bryan Singer himself will be directing the pilot. That's a big gun right there. And it might also explain why he's not doing Star Trek Discovery anymore.
No, that was Brian Fuller.
Oh, what's Singer? What is Brian
Singer is doing X-Men the movies.
Yeah.
Fuller is doing American Gods, and he did Hannibal and Pushing Daisies. And
okay. Well, not only did we have that, but we also have some news over with Cloak and Dagger.
Oh, this has me so excited. So we have two news items about Cloak and Dagger. The first one is that a director has been found for the pilot, Gina Prince Bythewood. I'm sorry. She has directed Shots Fired and Beyond the Light. And we've talked about this before, that they're going to work on it for Freeform, which used to be ABC Family.
Which used to be Fox Family.
Which used to be Fox Family.
Which used to be Fox Kids.
And also, there is a rumor. This one is not substantiated, but I really like this rumor, so I've included it. That Cloak and Dagger may have been cast. According to a source that MCU Exchange has, you know, somebody contacted them, Noah Gray Cabey from Heroes and Debbie Ryan from Radio Rebel have been cast as Tyrone Johnson, Cloak, and Tandy Bowen, Dagger. So Noah Gray Cabey, he was the like genius kid from Heroes. And he is like, I mean, I know that show was like 10 years ago, but it's weird that he's grown up
You know? Right, because he was like a cute little kid, and now he's like an adult.
It's weird.
Well, Talbot was in Heroes too. I mean,
yeah. But, you know, he looked like Adrian Pazdar, and now he looks like Adrian Pazdar. So
Adrian Pazdar,
now he's an adult, and now he looks like an adult.
Right. Yeah,
with a mustache taped to his face.
Yes.
Fair enough. Fair enough. Well, I was interested in this show when I first heard about it, and then I haven't really heard anything about it in at least 6 months. And so seeing this information, I'm getting excited about it again. And we'll see. And then finally, out of the 8 Inhumans episodes, because I think it's an 8 episode run right now, at least that's contracted, we have a director for 2 of them.
Yeah, Roel Reiny. I'm not sure if I pronounced that correctly, is going to be directing the first two episodes of the series. He's also worked on Black Sails and some other stuff that I haven't seen, but I keep meaning to watch Black Sails.
Okay. But the first two episodes are the ones that are going to be in theaters, right?
Yeah. Nice. They're the ones that are going to like IMAX.
Cool. Exactly. Do we have a date on that? I can't remember. It was like January.
There is a date. I don't remember what it is though.
September.
Oh really?
Yeah, I think it's September something.
I thought it was a mid-season replacement or something like that. I don't know. I guess I need to brush up on that. All right. Are you ladies ready to move on from the news into the feedback?
Yep.
Yar.
You guys, you listeners, you viewers on YouTube, you are great because you keep on tweeting us, hitting us up on email, hitting us up on Facebook with a lot of great stuff. This week is no exception. We're going to start it off with at Mr. Pericles. He tweeted us with a retweet of Bonnie Burton, basically with this awesome custom Jessica Jones doll. You guys take a look at that. Did you see it? It is awesome.
I've not seen it.
Yeah, it's basically, you know, Barbie size, but it's just like Jessica Jones. It's awesome, including her black leather coat, her jeans, and everything. It's awesome. So go ahead and hit us in the show notes or go to at Mr. Paracletes Twitter account to check that out. We also got a tweet from at Born to Eat Bacon. How you doing, sir? And he added, he retweeted Infinite Earths and he said, Black Adam to get his own solo DCEU film, which typically, being a DC property, we wouldn't talk over here on Marvel. But you know why we're going to talk about it on Marvel? Because our co-host over on Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. Long Box Edition, talking about the Marvel comics, his name is Black Adam. So I'm wondering, do you think that Black Adam is actually going to act in this film? Is that what's going to happen?
I would assume so.
Yeah. So congratulations, Black Adam. We were really looking forward to your film. And remember us little people when you get your Oscar. Ladies, at Born to Eat Bacon also tweeted us something else, didn't he?
Hashtag butt shot equality.
I think we can all get behind that.
Yeah.
Heyo.
That was a tip of the hat to last week's episode. Thank you very much, sir. And a frequent contributor to Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. podcast on the Twitter sphere is at Adana Girl. And she delivered some very sad news for us.
Miguel Ferrer died last week. And she reminded us that he was Iron Man 3's VP.
Also best known for his roles in NCIS and Twin Peaks.
I always knew him from Crossing Jordan.
Yeah. Forgot about that show.
Yeah, I loved that show.
Long time ago. Talking about Black Adam, he tweeted us with an awesome picture. Now, I have to give a little background here. Back when I did have a Facebook page at Stargate Pioneer, before Facebook booted me out, I was part of a cosplay group. And this cosplay group had all these great pictures of their vehicles, which they had transformed into S.H.I.E.L.D. vehicles. And so I had been missing that because I'm no longer on Facebook, but Black Adam not only delivered, but he actually saw this in person. And yes, it was an actual car that had S.H.I.E.L.D. logos all around it and everything. This is pretty cool. I need to move to Florida and see more stuff like this. It'd be awesome because up in the north where we get snow and grime and stuff, that sort of decals, it wouldn't last very long up here. It would rust out. A lot of salt on the roads up here. Black Adam also tweeted, Lauren, please enlighten everybody on this because this is pretty fun.
Oh, the Legends of Tomorrow / S.H.I.E.L.D. slip up?
Yeah, that's right. So Real Talk Reactions is a channel on YouTube, and they talk a lot about comic book shows and their reaction to it, and it's a video show. Well, they released, an outtake as one video itself, and what did they have to say?
I haven't actually seen this video.
Oh, I thought you did. Okay, so no. Basically they slipped up, and they do exactly what we did all the time, and they called Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., and they went, ha, 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 ha. So Black Adam forwarded onto us, so I took the Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. YouTube channel, and I commented on their video and said, yeah, it's thanks a lot. We get that all the time. And so they saw that there was actually a podcast called Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., and they just laughed hysterically, and it was a good time. A good time was had by all.
Yay.
Okay, Haley, we were talking about shipping names before. The operator, one of the founding members of Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., actually had an input on this. What did he have to say?
Well, he said, hey, # Mac-Elena. Yeah, I said it.
Hey, Mac-Elena.
Yep.
So are we going to change it from Yo Mac to Mac-Elena?
Eh.
Oh, you're going to ditz the operator like that. That's harsh.
Mac, but Mac-Elena is kind of fun.
Especially when you say, hey, Mac-Elena. Like
you got to sing it. You got
to
sing it.
Yeah, I mean, if you're going to say it like that every time, then yes, I will accept it. But you have to say it like that every time you say it.
See, I like Yo-Yo Mac because it sounds like Yo-Yo Ma. You know,
yep.
The cellist.
I don't know. Operator, if you're out there, you got to weigh in. The ladies are kind of swaying against you there. But cool pun.
I like anyway. It, but only if you sing it. Which means it doesn't come across so good on Twitter. But in person, I like it.
All right. The last feedback we got was from at Adana Girl, Christy, our gal, and she said, maybe an LMD of Sitwell will show up. So there she goes, bringing in the LMD, the first generation of LMD into the show. I think that's a great idea.
Well, hope springs eternal.
Yeah, I mean, it's the only way they could bring him back on the show. What with him being a puddle on a highway somewhere.
He's also gained a lot of weight. So he's the doctor on The Last Ship. He's the doctor of The Last Ship. So he's been around TV quite a bit. Actually, a lot of work. What's that?
That's good. He's still getting work. I like it when actors who are on stuff I like keep getting work.
That's right.
Enjoy. How does Tom O'Pinnicott not have his own show?
I know, right?
I don't think he wants his own show. I mean, but he was involved in what was a time travel show on Sci-Fi. It was actually a space. It was a Canadian. Oh my gosh, I can't remember. It's Cameron, Detective Cameron.
I know which one you're talking about.
Oh,
and I blanked out on it and it just ended. Continuum.
Yep. Tom O'Pinnicott was on a season or two of Continuum. I know he did that. And I know he's been in a lot of other things as well. Dollhouse and stuff like that. So
he is very tall.
Mm-hmm. Apparently so. Yeah. All right. We're going to now do what we call as walking this one out. As we mentioned before, next week we will be back to discuss Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Season 4, Episode 12, Hot Potato Soup. And just a reminder, you can come join us 9 p.m. Eastern at www.geeks.com www.geeks.live, just like Stephen J., generic name, and Felix. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us tonight.
And thank you for everybody who comments on Facebook, who leaves us feedback on Twitter, who gets a hold of us during the live tweets or when they're watching, or just sends us news stories during the week. We really appreciate it.
And thank you to everyone who participated in our contest. Congratulations to Calvin on winning, but also thank you to Born to Eat Bacon, Anthony Bachman, and Michelle for sending in your input. We will have another contest coming up soon, so keep coming back.
That's right. Thank you very much. I think we're done here for the week. And until next time, I'm Director Stargate Pioneer.
I'm Agent Haley.
And I'm Agent Lauren.
Bye. See you guys next week.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you for listening. If you want to leave us feedback, go to gunnageek.com and you will find all our contact information and other shows. You can also visit legendsofshield.com where you'll find our complete archive of podcasts. The music heard on this podcast is by Kevin McLeod, found at incompetech.com, and also artists on pond5.com and audiojungle.net. The opinions heard on this podcast are those of the individual hosts and do not represent Stargate Pioneer Productions, Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., or Gunna Geek. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is the property of the Disney Corporation, Marvel Studios, and ABC. No infringement is intended. Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. is copyright 2017.